Hey guys, welcome back. We'll look into the electrophilic addition of alkenes and predict the products based on an important rule, Markovnikov rule, and also how we can complementary Markovnikov rule using peroxides. Okay. So when you look into alkenes, we already know that alkenes have a double bond or a pi cloud. So this is an electron rich area. So this can attack an electrophile. Electrophile being somebody who loves electrons. So they can be attacked by a nucleophile. In our case, in alkenes, the nucleophile is the pi cloud. So that will be step one of your electrophilic addition, where the electrophile is attacked by the pi cloud electrons, leading to formation of a carbocation. Because the electrophile does not come with pair of electrons, the pi cloud is basically two electrons. Both of them are utilized to form a bond between a carbon atom and the electrophile, as shown here. So the other carbon atom loses its share of electron, so it is deficient of electron right here. So this becomes a carbocation. This carbocation is sp2 hybridized, and it is going to be trigonal planar. So don't worry about this yet. You will get this statement later. Plus on the most substituted carbon, we'll get this later. Let it be there for now. This is just a schematic of how it works. This is the pi cloud again. It's rich in electrons. It goes and attacks the electrophile and attaches itself to one of the carbon. The other carbon, it used to use this bond for the pi bond. Okay. Now it has become empty. So this is going to be one bond here, one bond here, one bond here, three sigma bonds. So this is sp2 hybridization. To start with, the carbon was sp2 because pi bonds don't take part in hybridization. We have seen this in chemical bonding. So now I have an empty p orbital. Okay, this empty p orbital can be attacked by somebody who can bring in electrons, because it's all empty and it doesn't have any electrons to share. The person coming in has to bring the electrons, and in our case that would be the nucleophile. Okay, this next step is going to be, once any time you go through a carbocation, it's going to try to rearrange to more stable carbocation. The energetics is extremely favorable in this regard. So it will rearrange. At this point, I don't want to talk about rearrangement. Let's go for simple carbocations where rearrangement is not necessary. Already a stable carbocation is formed. So an attack of the electrophile by the pi cloud, formation of a carbocation, rearrangement if possible. And now once I rearranged, I have a more stable carbocation, but it cannot be stable as it is because it's a charged species. So it's just an intermediate. Now, as I told you, there is an empty orbital that can be attacked by an incoming nucleophile. The nucleophile comes with a pair of electrons. The nucleophile can be a negative species or a neutral species with lone pair like water. So that nucleophile attacks this carbon. Basically, what you have done is you have done addition of electrophile and nucleophile to this carbon double bond. Okay, so AB addition. If I am adding both the electrophile and nucleophile, why do we call it the electrophilic addition of alkenes? Why not nucleophilic addition, or why not both? The reason being, what is first getting attached is the electrophile, and also this is the slowest step. Okay, for this reason, this is called an electrophilic addition of alkenes. Here, just the statement from the last slide, it will always go through most stable carbonium ion. If you see, I can go back and say right there. Okay, we're going to see it in detail. So when I have a alkene, this is an unsymmetrical alkene. When you say an alkene is unsymmetrical, when both sides of the double bond have different species. Okay, so if I take this alkene, okay, 2-methyl-butuene, and add a hydrogen atom, the hydrogen can go to this carbon or this carbon, because the pi cloud is symmetrical in between, so it can go and attack. So if it attaches to the carbon on the right side, I would end up with this. If it attaches to the carbon on the left side, I'll end up with this. Okay, now here it says add H plus to tertiary carbon. It says X, it doesn't mean it will not happen. Says don't do it, because that's going to give you least stable carbocation compared to the two. See, as we can see, this is a tertiary carbocation, this is a secondary carbocation. a tertiary is more stable because of the number of hyperconjugated structures. Okay, we have seen hyperconjugation separately. So this is going to have 3 alpha hydrogen and 2 alpha hydrogen now for a sum total of 8 alpha hydrogen, whereas in this case this carbon has 3 alpha hydrogen on the right side and 1 alpha hydrogen on the left side, sum total of 4. Obviously 8 trumps 4, so this is going to be the most stable carbocation. And we have seen this, you don't need to count the alpha hydrogens in the NEET exam. We have seen this order before: are benzylic greater than allylic greater than 3 degree, 2 degree, 1 degree. So, and there are some diphenyl methyl carbocation, triphenyl methyl carbocation over here, but at least this, if you remember this order, okay, just looking at, okay, 3 degree, 2 degree, I don't have to worry. In the exam, how do you do? This is given, okay, just ignore all the other steps. This is given to you. Our first step is going to be addition of H+. So the H+ can go here, giving you a carbocation here, or the H+ can attach here, giving you a carbocation. So put a plus on both sides, possible ones, okay? Then look at it. If plus is on here, this is going to be 2 degree. Plus is on here, it's going to be 3 degree. So obviously, hydrogen will get attached here and plus sign will be here, okay? You don't have to draw the mechanism, just you can finish it off where the molecule is printed itself. Okay, all right. So now what you will get is, if you were to do this reaction, this will be a major product, this will be a minor product. Okay, this is still formed but very less in amount. Right. So now the same thing is shown differently here. So it's a different molecule. So the H+ can get attached. Now you can see that, ignore the remaining schematic. Look at it. Okay, so if hydrogen attaches here, I'll get a positive sign here. If hydrogen attaches here, I'll get a positive sign here. Obviously, this is going to be more stable because this is going to be a 3 degree carbocation. This will be a 2 degree carbocation. So this is going to happen. That's what we have here. So this is a sp2 hybridized carbocation, trigonal, planar in shape. The Br- of the nucleophile can attack from both sides. If you have a carbocation which is trigonal, planar in shape, okay, a nucleophile can attack this way or this way equally, okay? So if it can do equally, then what you get is, you actually get a racemic mixture, okay? Both the S configuration and the R configuration you will get, if suppose the carbon is chiral. In this case, it is not, that's why I don't show you. It's not chiral because the carbon is attached to bromine, is okay, another carbon is okay, but this is methyl, this is methyl, this is methyl. So this is not going to be a chiral. Had it been a chiral carbon, you will end up with a racemic mixture. All right, let's do some example. So now I have HCl addition. Okay, HBr and HCl are going to go to the same thing. So HCl addition, the hydrogen can go to this carbon or it can go to this carbon. If it goes to this carbon, hydrogen attaches, you get the 3 degree carbocation. If I do this here, I get a carbocation here, 2 degree carbocation. Obviously, this is more stable. Hence, we get the corresponding product. Okay, this is a tertiary. This is going to be 1 degree. This is just a terminal carbon, so it is 1 degree. So this is going to be a 1 degree, which is way less stable compared to a 3 degree. So when I say X, it means it's not favorable, doesn't mean it will not happen at all. It is going to happen very, very little. Okay. So the not formed, okay, meaning extremely low amount that you don't consider it as a product or significant product at all. Also, you guys have to get used to the naming, because for all you know, this could be given as a just a statement question with names, so you should be able to do. When you do, okay, you need to practice doing just the carbon skeleton. For example, if they give you methylpropene, okay, obviously I don't have to say it is 2-methylpropene. If it is methylpropene, the only possible is 2-methylpropene. Now if I have to do hydrogen attachment, I can get hydrogen attached here and carbocation here, or hydrogen attached here, carbocation here. This is going to be more stable. And then that's your product. That's how fast you should be able to do just using the carbon skeleton diagram. Right, now let's go into Markovnikov rule. It's an extremely important one. Okay, without this, you cannot do addition reactions of alkenes and alkynes as well. When a protic acid, in our case HX, is added to an alkene, okay, or an alkyne, we are going to see the same thing later. So when a HX is added, the hydrogen atom which is going to be attached first, the hydrogen atom of HX becomes bonded to the carbon that has the greatest number of hydrogen atom attached to the starting alkene. Okay, remember it this way, like dissolves like. Similarly, you can say hydrogen will go attached to the carbon that has a lot more hydrogens. Okay, that's one way to remember. Okay, all right, now we have here propene. So if hydrogen has to get attached, it will go get attached itself to the carbon with the most number of hydrogens. This carbon has two hydrogens, this carbon has one hydrogen, so hydrogen will get attached here and you get a carbocation, you get this. Now if you see, it's self-explanatory. If hydrogen goes and attaches to the carbon with more hydrogen, the other carbocation you're going to get is always going to be more stable. Look at the other way around. If this hydrogen attaches here, I'll get a primary carbocation which is less stable than a secondary carbocation. This is named after Russian chemist Markovnikov. This is another way of remembering it. The rich gets richer. Basically, whoever is rich with hydrogen get even more richer with hydrogen. So here we have a molecule 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 carbon means bute, and it is between 1 and 2 carbon. So bute-1-ene. So when I have bute-1-ene, the carbon attached to 2 hydrogen versus carbon attached to 1 hydrogen. This is the computation you have. Obviously, hydrogen will get attached to a carbon with 2 hydrogen, giving you a carbocation right there. And there is no need for any rearrangement. So the chlorine will get attached here. And again, if you see here, I have not said this is not going to form. This is going to be a minor product. Hence, I have grayed it out. Okay. As simple as that, HBr and HCl, they're going to do the same thing. Okay. Now this will happen only when you have unsymmetrical alkene like bute-1-ene. If I take bute-2-ene, this carbon and this carbon are exactly same, symmetrical. So it doesn't matter hydrogen goes here or here, you will get exactly same product. Hence, Markovnikov rule is valid only for alkenes that are unsymmetrical. So why does this happen? Now when you see here, you can see just what we have seen before. Addition of a hydrogen to a carbon with more hydrogens gives you a more stable carbocation, unlike the other possible route where carbon is with the less number of hydrogen gets the hydrogen. This carbon has one hydrogen, this carbon has two. So when I put the extra hydrogen to this carbon, I get a secondary carbocation which is more stable than a primary carbocation, corresponding major product. Okay. So again, remember this, the rich gets richer. In Markovnikov term, the carbon with rich with hydrogens gets richer with hydrogens. Right, now let's do a couple of examples. As I've always told you guys, the best way to do organic is practice problems. How much of a theory you do, it's not going to be enough. So I'll try to do problems along with you here. So HBr addition, H is going to get attached. These are the two possibilities. Okay, so I'm going to draw both of them. CH3 and hydrogen is attached here. I get a plus charge here. And the hydrogen is attached here. Obviously, this is more stable. So the corresponding product would be, after this carbocation is formed, bromine or the nucleophile attacks this carbocation. Okay, all right, over here I have a carbon here attached to 1, 2, 3, 4, means no hydrogens. Here the carbon has one hydrogen. So this is rich in hydrogens, so the hydrogen will go to here. and our new hydrogen as attached here. Okay, this is our hydrogen, this is already present, this is a carbocation. Now what we have is, I'm ignoring my hydrogens, they are present. Okay, that will be a product. So now you once you practice enough, you won't be writing all this down, you'll be able to finish it off right here. For example, if this molecule is given in the exam, what you would be doing is, okay, if hydrogen attaches here, I get a carbocation here. Hydrogen attaches here, I'll get a carbocation here. Ignore the double bond because it's going to be gone. Now this is going to be a 3-degree carbocation, this is 2-degree carbocation, this is going to be stable. So I put a bromine here, I get my product. That's how fast and efficient you have to get to be able to finish your paper in JEE and NEET. All right, next step is our step after the formation of carbocation, a rearrangement of a carbocation. Okay, we have seen rearrangement of carbocation before. Okay, there are three ways of doing it. One is hydride shift. If it is not allowed or not convenient, you go for methyl shift. If not methyl shift, you go for phenyl shift. So here when you see, I have a double bond here. This carbon has two hydrogens, this carbon has one hydrogen. So carbon one going to get the hydrogen because rich gets richer. So I have shown you that here. Okay, so now what has happened? If you see, if hydrogen goes here, what is the product you're going to get? So if it goes as per plan, it should have been this way. Hydrogen, hydrogen, I'll get one more hydrogen and chlorine here. Okay, so one should have got hydrogen, two should have got chlorine, but this is the product which looks completely different. These two are completely different. These two are positional isomers. Okay, so obviously something has happened. Basically what you have done is carbocation shift. Okay, let's take the same molecule. The first step is very simple. Attack of an electrophile with a pi cloud of electrons, formation of carbocation. So I have formed a carbocation right here. Okay, hydrogen is attached to the carbon with more hydrogens, formed a carbocation. This is a 2-degree carbocation. Obviously it is stable, but it is going to look at its neighbor and see whether can I get more stable. If I go here, I can become 3-degree carbocation. So my hydrogen gets shifted. So this hydrogen gets shifted over here with a pair of electrons. It goes as H minus hydride. So it goes with the electrons. This carbon doesn't already have electrons, so it needs the hydrogen to come with electrons. This hydrogen goes here. The carbocation comes here. Okay. Now this is a 3-degree carbocation, which is more stable than a 2-degree carbocation. Now that I have a more stable carbocation, my nucleophile will attack the newly formed carbocation and give you the corresponding product. Okay, so in our previous case, I drew the product that we would expect that will be formed. That will be a minor product. This will be a major product. Now, why does it happen? Okay, it all has to do with the energetics. Okay, formation of the carbocation, first carbocation, is the slowest step. After that, everything else is fast. So what it means is, in kinetics, if a step is fast, it means its activation energy is low. So the activation energy to convert from one carbocation or rearrange to from one carbocation to another, and also the activation energy for the nucleophile attacking to get the final product, both are low. So they are extremely favorable. All right, now that we have seen hydride shift, what if I don't have an alpha hydrogen, as in this case? So if we look at the previous case, I had a hydrogen right here. I've chosen a case where I don't have a hydrogen. Okay, so I have attached my hydrogen to this carbon. With this, I am having two carbons. It has become three now. I have formed a carbocation right here. Previous case, a hydrogen moved. If hydrogen is not there, an alkyl group can move. Because it has no alpha hydrogen, I have no other option but the alkyl can move. If the alkyl moves, it has to move with the bonded pair of electrons, and the carbocation shifts here. So as you can see, the carbocation has migrated and chlorine has attached to itself. Okay. So now what would we normally expect? Normally expect is hydrogen getting attached here and the chlorine here. So I would have this carbon attached to three other carbon, this hydrogen forming a carbocation, and this becomes CH3, and the Cl will get attached. Okay, here these two are positional isomers. Actually, in this case, it won't be even a positional isomer, it might be even a chain isomer as well, because carbon chain itself is different. Okay, so anyways, the rearrangement ends up giving you a structural isomer. Okay, and the most stable one is going to be the major product, the other one is going to be a minor product. Okay, again, previous slide we saw hydride shift is not possible, and alkyl shift will happen. If this is tough for the alkaline hydride shift and stability of carbocation, I advise you to go and watch the video on carbocation and its stabilities and also the shifts, so it's easier. Alright, this is the toughest part in me. The same rearrangement of carbocation but in ring. Okay. If you see here, I have a hydrogen atom being attached by a pi cloud, a carbocation is formed. Now, this is a special case where this carbon is 3 degree attached to carbon, carbon and carbon, and that's a hydrogen. So it is convenient to say that we can get this, the hydrogen can migrate and get this. Okay, and then when you put bromine to this one, you get this. This is formed, but it's minor. Okay, but this is the major product that is formed. Okay. Now, instead of an hydride shift, what has happened is this whole methyl bond is shifted. Okay, now imagine that this is just a separate group, CH3 group. You just did shifting last slide. Here, what happens is that CH3 happens to be part of a ring. So the ring just opens up from a 4-member ring to a 5-member ring. Now I have a 2-degree carbocation giving you a 2-degree carbocation. Okay. You see here, this carbon is attached to 1 carbon, 2 carbon, 3 carbons and 1 hydrogen. Okay. But when it moves, it loses the bond with one of the carbon. Okay. This carbon is attached to 2 other carbons. Now it is attached to 3 other carbons. Okay. This used to be attached to 3 carbon, now it is attached to only 2 carbons. Okay. And it has become a 2-degree carbocation. Alright, so this has happened. Now if you see, I have done a second shift. 1 to alkyl shift, 1 to hydride shift. Now the hydride can shift. Okay, carbocation can shift multiple times because this is the slowest step. All the other ones are energetically favorable. In NEET, in general, they don't give multiple shift questions. One shift will usually be the answer. Here, what happens is, this is a 4-membered ring. This is a 5-membered ring. Okay. So, this can also give you one of the products. The bromine can be. Sometimes they don't give you this, they give you NEET straight away. They don't ask you for the second shift. But if this is given, this is the most stable product. Okay. Now, when you see, I have a hydrogen here, this hydrogen can shift and the carbocation can be formed here. This is 3 degree, okay, and then you get the corresponding product. So why do you shift from 4-membered ring to 5-membered ring? Although now it is not strictly in your syllabus, it's a good idea to remember just the order. This is the ring strain. Okay, it was discovered by German chemist Bayer. So Bayer strain theory. He actually received Nobel Prize for this. Okay, in JE and JE Advanced, the ring strain comes. JE mains not so much, but JE Advanced does have ring strain, cyclohexane. Here, all you guys want to know is, just look at this is strain. Strain is bad. Okay, so which one has the least strain? A 6-membered ring has the least strain compared to 5-membered ring and 7-membered ring. And larger rings and smaller rings are less stable. So what you want is, this is what you want to remember. If it is a 4-membered ring, it will get converted to 5-membered ring. If it's a 7-membered ring, it will try to get converted to 6-membered ring. If it's a 5-membered ring, it will get converted to 6-membered ring, but not that much. The strain that you're going to release from going to 5 is not that hard. Okay. So 5 doesn't usually go to 6 membered ring. Okay, it stops at 5 most of the time. Depending on the answer, if there is a 6 membered answer, then that is going to be your option. Don't go look for it. 5 membered ring is perfectly fine. The incentive to go from 5 to 6 is not a lot. But this is what you want to remember. 4 will always try to relieve it to 5. They might not give you 3. If they give you 3, same 3 can go to 4 or if possible 5. Okay. Similarly, 7 will go to 6. No need to remember the values. Just know that 6 is the most stable, then 5. Alright, so now I have another example here. If you see, it's just the same molecule, one extra methyl group here. So when you see here, the H plus gets attached to this carbon, I get a carbocation, straightforward. Now exactly like here, I can do an alkyl shift, the methyl shift, but this methyl will shift, giving you a tertiary carbon, okay, which will give you the corresponding. See here, there are two shifts here, only one shift. This is more likely to come in neat. Okay, so all you have to do is, when I have a ring, 4-membered ring, right away when you see a 5-membered ring in the options, see, nobody is asking you to write down the subjective question. Objective question, the question has 4-membered ring, options have 5-membered ring, it has to blink for you right away. Okay, there is ring expansion, carbocation rearrangement. Once you know that it's going to be carbocation ring expansion, it's actually easy to write down. Okay. Alright, let's predict the product. Now when you see this one, this is HBr. Hydrogen will go and attach here and carbocation here. Okay, straightforward. A pi cloud will attack the hydrogen. Hydrogen goes here, carbocation here, because it's a secondary carbocation. So I have this. Now I have an option. This methyl can shift or this bonded methyl can shift. It's not methyl. Bonded CH2, methylene can shift. Okay, I can do both, but by shifting this, I get to a 6-membered ring, meaning a little bit more stable. Okay, so now I have shifted it, I got a 6-membered ring. Now this is a 3-degree. Okay, perfectly happy. So I'll get the corresponding product. So this is given to you in the question, this is given to you in the answer. This is, you have to do this, but you don't have to worry. First thing you want to do, look at the question. This is the fastest way. Look at the question and look at the options. Okay, ring expansion is there. First, right away, count the number of carbon atoms. Ring is 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Look at the options. If there is any product that is not 9 carbon atoms, they are wrong. Right away, you might be left with only 2 of the options. Then look at ring expansion. Just because you have 5-membered ring, don't go for a 6-membered option. It has to be a valid product. Okay. Now let's look at the energetics of it. Okay. First step is formation of a carbocation. I have told you that many times over this lecture. That's the slowest step, meaning the first step is going to have the highest activation energy. Study these reactions and see which one has the highest activation energy. Obviously, this one has the highest activation energy for the first step, slowest step. So this would be the correct option. Now I have formed this carbocation right here. Then it goes through another transition state to form this carbocation. Then it goes to another transition state to form this product. Okay. So what do you have here is, this goes through transition state 1 and gives you intermediate 1. This goes through transition state 2, gives you intermediate 2. This goes through transition state 3 and give you product. So here I have my reactant. This is my transition state 1, the highest energy. This is my intermediate 1. This is my transition state 2. Compared to this, this is faster because the activation energy isn't much. This is my intermediate 2. Now if you look carefully, this carbocation is more stable than this. So it is less in energy. Okay, so if you see, it is less in energy. Then this goes through transition state 3 and product. Transition state is nothing but whatever you're going to do, partially formed. For example, bromine is going to get attached here. This bromine bond is partially formed. That's your transition state. Similarly, when if this methyl is going to go here, this bond is partially broken. This bond is partially formed. That's what your transition states are. Here when you see the transition state would be, the bond between H and Br is partially broken. The bond between this carbon and this hydrogen is partially formed. That will be a transition state 1. All right. Now, we have seen into Markovnikov. Now, we are going to look into the anti-Markovnikov addition, meaning we have always gone through a more stable carbocation and corresponding product. Now, we are going to see how we can get the other product. The mechanism that do not involve a carbocation intermediate may have regioselectivity, meaning which region is going to be selective, not dictated by the Markovnikov rule. Markovnikov rule is for a carbocation intermediate, but if there is another mechanism that do not involve a C+, then obviously you are going to go through a different rule. In the presence of peroxides, HBr addition to C double bond C. So we have been seeing HBr addition to C double bond C. In presence of a peroxide, it will add via a free radical mechanism, altogether a different mechanism, giving rise to anti-Markovnikov product. Okay. The peroxide effect, or is also called Karasch effect, was hypothesized and proven by University of Chicago scientists, a Ukrainian scientist, Karasch. And this is actually complementary to your Markovnikov addition. So one of them gives you one product. What if you don't want that product for any other reaction? You can use the Karasch effect. So here if you see, normally we would expect the hydrogen to get attached to the terminal carbon, bromine to the central carbon, but I have the opposite product here when I have peroxide. Now the most important thing you have to be careful is, the moment you see peroxide, I have seen students doing this, but peroxide effect is only for HBr and not for HCl and HI. Okay, the reason not for HF as well, the reason is very simple. Okay, first is formation of a free radical, and then addition of that free radical to this double bond, formation of another free radical and forming this. In turn, when you do your HF HCl, this goes through two steps. Okay, the first step is XO, the second step is endo. In HI, the first step is endo, the second step is XO. Okay, what happens in these three cases, just remember this way, you don't even have to remember all this. In these three cases, the total reaction is endo, so not going to be possible. Whereas when it comes to HBr, it is XO, so HBr alone shows peroxide effect. This is very critical that you remember. If there is HCl and peroxide here, you will still form Markovnikov product. Right. Here is a mechanism. It looks like clumsy a lot, but it's actually very, very simple. You have a peroxide, it gives you peroxide radical, RO dot. Okay. RO dot reacts with HBr, one of your reagent, and give you Br dot. This is what we want. Okay, I have got my Br dot. Okay, this has one electron. Now when it goes attacks the ring, the double bond. Okay, the double bond has two electrons, pi electrons. It needs only one to form a bond, forms a bond and gives you a peroxide. Okay, so now in the previous mechanism, we have added, in the Markovnikov mechanism, first is addition of H plus, second is addition of Br minus. Okay, so first is addition of H plus gives you carbocation. So I am looking to form more stable carbocation. Here, anti-Markovnikov product, peroxide effect, first step is addition of Br dot, second is addition of H dot. Okay, so here Br dot addition gives you C dot. Exact same here, once Br dot gets attached, you're going to look for most stable free radical. Again, you're going to do the exact same thing, most stable free radical. So this Karasch mechanism is not anti-Markovnikov mechanism, it's anti-Markovnikov product. The mechanism is still most stable free radical and then addition of H. But obviously, this is not the only set of reaction that will happen. Okay, look at the free radical. So we have seen this in alkanes. Chain initiation, left side no free radical, right side there is free radical. chain propagation, both sides there are free radical. Free radical here, free radical here. Free radical here, free radical. Chain termination, on the left side there is free radical. Right side there is no free radical. But obviously, this is not the only termination steps. There are other possible termination steps. Termination steps are very simple. Take this entire mechanism. Anywhere you see a free radical, it will join with another free radical. These two can combine to give you this. That's one termination. Okay. Similarly, I have BR dot joined with another BR dot. This is this termination. This dot combines with one more of that and give you another product. Okay. And this R dot will combine with BR dot to give you another product. Okay. So any of them are possible chain termination, but this is the most relevant one for us. Right. What are the peroxides that can be given to you below the arrow? Hydrogen peroxide is very simple. This is more commonly given to you, benzoyl peroxide. Okay. So this group is RCO group because it has a phenyl ring. This is benzoyl and I have here peroxide. So all of them have the peroxide cleavage. All right. So this is acetyl. So this is acetyl group. Diethyl. This is diethyl. Okay. Remember these peroxides. So any of them can be given to you. If there is peroxide below the arrow and HBr above the arrow, that's going to be anti-Markovnikov of product. Now let's look at the energetics of it. This is actually two-part diagram. Okay. This is the starting material. Okay. This is where you start. Okay. To one side you have anti-Markovnikov product, to other side you have Markovnikov product. Okay, so this is propene I'm taking. H plus can go to this side or this side. If H plus goes to this side, I get a carbocation here, right there, and which can get attacked to the nucleophile, and then H plus goes here, I get the carbocation here, which gets attacked by the nucleophile getting here. Now why does the carbocation get formed here? Hydrogen attaches here. I start here. See, I have two options, to go this way, to go to the right, or to go to the left. Which side the activation energy is higher? The right side the activation energy is higher. So this is going to be more difficult to go through. Okay, high activation energy, whereas this is low activation energy. If you draw the transition states, okay, for example, if I were to draw just for clarity, alright, hydrogen is going to go to the other side. So hydrogen is to the other side. This bond is partially broken. This is a transition state and this is partially positive charge. That's more stable than this partial positive charge. So obviously this is more stable, means less in energy. So that consequently means less activation energy. Once you form this, the corresponding next steps are easier. So it's always, it's the first step or the slowest step that matters. This activation energy versus this activation energy. The one that is the smallest will obviously be ready to go. All right, let's look at a couple of examples. The reaction of this corresponding molecule with HBr gives you. So this is how you're going to do in the exam. Four options are given. So a double bond is given. I can put a H plus here, okay, put a positive charge here, or I can put a H plus here, put a positive charge here. Let's put this as 1, this is 2. Alright, so this is 2 degree, this is benzylic. So obviously this is more stable. So the hydrogen will go here, benzylic, I don't have to rearrange, and this is stable as well because this is plus R effect. This is stabilizing the positive charge here. So obviously the hydrogen will go here, bromine will go here. So you will get beta. This is anti-Markovnikov product. This would have happened in presence of peroxide. Okay. These two, you're substituting in the ring. You're removing OH and putting Br. So that is nucleophilic substitution reaction in the ring. That's going to be hard to do. One other example. Okay, if I can do Markovnikov mechanism, can I do for alkyne? It's exactly same. I'm going to do only one equivalent. So the same rule applies. Hence I chose this example. Hydrogen gets attached to the carbon that is more that is attached to more hydrogen. So the hydrogen will go here. Carbocation will be formed here. It will rearrange if needed. If not, the bromine will go there. So I'm going to have C3CH2+. Now this C3H7, you can leave it as it is. Depending on what it is, it could rearrange. Okay. Now, in our case, hydrogen is attached here, bromine will come here. So you're going to have C3H7CBr. Oh no, sorry. Okay, I think we are missing a carbon here. Okay, straightforward. Okay, this is not possible because there is two BRs. There is only one equivalent. That's not possible. This is not possible. So it's just a competition between the two. This is possible if I have used peroxide. Right. Okay. Now let's look at a couple of more example. HCl peroxide. So HCl does not get influenced by peroxide. So the hydrogen goes and attaches to the carbon with more number of hydrogens. Right there, chlorine goes here. So you get a carbocation here, okay, and the corresponding product, whereas peroxide effect is for HBr, so you get different product. Okay, you can practice writing the carbocation by yourself for this corresponding one and see whether it will rearrange or not for this. Anti-Markovnikov of product addition of HBr is not observed in. Okay. So they're telling you if I wait to use peroxide with HBr, it's not absorbed in which one. So basically, your Markovnikov addition or anti-Markovnikov addition can only be done if the alkene is unsymmetrical. If it's a symmetrical alkene, they cannot happen. So when you see butuene is symmetrical. If you draw the mechanism, there is no way you can get anti-Markovnikov product. However you do, for example, if you have to draw this butuene, there is both the carbons are same. So there is no carbon that has least number of hydrogen or most number of hydrogen. So there is impossible to predict an anti-Markovnikov product for this one. Okay. So as simple as that, they are looking at which one is symmetrical or not. And I would like you guys to remember that two examples that come in neat over and over that are symmetrical alkenes. One is butuene, the other one is cyclohexene. They are symmetrical, so it doesn't really matter whether it is Markovnikov or anti-Markovnikov. It's going to give you the same product. Alright, next example, if you look at it, this is a special case where I add HBr, both are exactly same butadiene, so it doesn't really matter which double bond you get attached to. One thing we know, hydrogen gets attached to the carbon with the most number of hydrogen, so let's call it this carbon. Okay, so if it attaches, I get a plus sign here. Okay, now what can happen is this positive sign here can undergo resonance, okay, and give you this. Okay, because this is allylic carbocation. Allylic carbocation is stabilized by resonance, so I get this. Now both are equally stable. Okay. Now if you see, both are equally stable in terms of allylic carbocation, but this is more stable in general because, or actually I would rather say the product is more stable. Okay. Let's come to this in a minute. So both are equally stable carbocations. I have formed those. But molecule by itself, this is more stable. The Br- can attack the corresponding carbocation and give you the product. So why would this be more stable? Straightforward, this is more substituted alkene. Meaning more number of alpha hydrogen, more number of hyperconjugated structures. Okay, so because of this factor, you will not get this product, you will get this product predominantly. Alright, so now what does it mean? What it means is thermodynamically this is controlled. Thermodynamics has to deal with stability. So this is more stable than this compound. The compound on the right side is more stable, so thermodynamically this is going to be the major product. Kinetically controlled means how fast it can happen. See, from here to here means it's an extra step. So if you were to do it very fast, you will get this compound. If you were to give it time, you will get this compound. Now here what I have attached is, if you take carbon numbers, okay, we can say this is 1, 2, 3, 4, correct? So if you just number this way, this is 1, 2 addition. So carbon 1 and carbon 2 get the addition, whereas this is 1, 4 addition. Carbon 1 gets the hydrogen, carbon 4 gets the bromine. So 1, 4 addition is going to give you a more stable product. 1, 2 addition is going to give you a product that is going to be kinetically controlled, meaning very, very fast. All right. Okay, this one, predict the product. This is very simple. I have a HBr, I have a double bond. So this is what you have to do in the exam. Hydrogen gets attached here, I get a carbocation here. Hydrogen gets attached here, I get a carbocation here. This carbocation is benzylic. This carbocation is also benzylic. Okay, now the tiebreaker is going to be this group. This is a plus R group. Plus R stabilizes carbocation. So this carbocation is more stable. So in the final product, bromine will be attached over here. Okay. Oops, sorry. Now, why don't we do just one right here, where I'm going to start with the same type. C, double bond C. I have drawn the same, except my OH is on the meta position now. Meta position is minus I. So this carbocation is going to be more stable than this carbocation because this is minus I. So as long as the OH is in ortho or para, okay, this carbocation is going to be stable because ortho and para gives you plus R. Ortho gives you minus I, but it is not that important compared to plus R. Whereas when you have a meta, it doesn't help in electron density. It actually withdraws it. So this carbocation is more stable. Now here I am asking you a question without giving you options. In the exam they'll actually give you 4 options, so it might be even easier. All right, predict the products when HBr is attached to this one. So they've given you this. So HBr is going to be attached to this. There is no peroxide, so we can say that hydrogen will get attached here, a positive sign will come, and bromine will get attached. Okay, so my product is, maybe even I'll go through this way. All right, now I'll get this. My hydrogen here, methyl group was already there, bromine is here, this is going to be here. Okay, this is stable carbocation, 3 degree, no need to rearrange. Now look at your chiral carbons. Okay, this is chiral attached to different groups, and also this is chiral. Okay, so let's say for example this carbon, let's assume a geometry, we can actually do it if you want. Okay, when you look into it, this is methyl group, this is alkyl group, this is alkyl attached to a bromine. So this is going to be your priority 1, priority 2, priority 3, clockwise R. Okay, so this carbon is R. What about this carbon? It has just gone through a carbocation mechanism, means that can be attached by the nucleophile, in our case bromine, on both sides. If one side gives you R, other side gives you S. So the product you are going to get R, this carbon is R, the other carbon, this one could be R. R, this carbon is R, this does not change at all, this could be S. So RR and RS, these are related as pair of diastereomers. Okay, if diastereomer, what it is tough for you, go and look at the isomerism example. This level might be difficult for somebody who is seeing it for the first time, definitely a class 11 student or a crash course student, but a year-long student would find this extremely simple. With practice, you will be able to get this. So the key here is very, very simple. Two things. They're talking about diastereomer and enantiomer. Okay, how are they related? If enantiomer is RR SS, diastereomers if it is RR, RS and SR diastereomers. Okay, so all I have to do is first take care of the HBR addition. Okay, if I do HBR addition, because I'm asking optical property, all you have to do is figure out number of chiral carbons. If you figure out number of chiral carbons and there is only one, okay, only one, you cannot have a diastereomer. If the molecule has R, the other one will be S. HBR addition carbocation mechanism means it has to be a diastereomer. But if there is more than one chiral carbon, think about diastereomers. Okay, this is just a representation. Now, if we were to do just as a review, so we know that this is R. Okay, here bromine is the more higher priority group. It has to be towards you. So whatever, we can do it over here. Okay, if we take this, bromine is priority one. This carbon is attached to a carbon with another methyl group. So this is priority two. This is carbon with CH2. This is carbon with CH3CH2. This is carbon just CH. This is priority three. This is methyl priority four. So priority four is away from you. 1, 2, 3. This is S. So that's automatically R. So this is RR. This is RS. Pair of diastereomers. Okay. All right. Now what we have seen so far is just a detailed look into Markovnikov, anti-Markovnikov addition and the corresponding products. I have kept it as a separate lecture so that when we go through alkenes reactions, it will be extremely faster. Okay, this needs its own attention, so I am doing it as a separate lecture. Do carefully, and whenever the products are given, make sure that you first put your carbocation on the left side, the reactant, printed reactant, put the carbocation on that one, see whether it will form more stable carbocation, see whether it will undergo rearrangement, accordingly choose the product. Okay, good luck, guys.